So this morning we are continuing a series that we started a couple weeks ago, which was actually our most requested series topic for 2018, which was, of course, how to listen to God, which, as I said, in my opinion, is one of the most important things I can ever teach you how to do, because when you're in the midst of making some big decision, when you're in the midst of just making a small decision, it's kind of good to know what God would have you do if you decided to live your life for Him, right? And so we're talking about that. In other words, how do you recognize it when God is speaking to you, and what do you do about what He says? Because make no mistake, God is still speaking to us every day, all the time. In fact, as we said last time, the Bible shows us He often uses four main means to speak to us. Remember these? We'll put them on the screen there real quick. He most certainly, definitely will speak to you through the Bible. That is the clearest, easiest way to hear from God. If you have opened your Bible and read those words, you have heard from God. That is His word, and that is the main way He will talk to you. He'll also sometimes speak directly to your soul, basically, through His Holy Spirit. And He'll use other godly believers in the church at times, and He'll most definitely use circumstances to nudge you in certain directions. Which, by the way, if you missed that sermon or you just want to catch it again, it is always online, totally free through our website. Please catch it this week. Because again, this is one of the most important things I could ever teach you how to do. Maybe the most important after how to be saved by Jesus. And we don't want you to miss a single part of it. But as we ended last time, we kind of asked this question. Hey, if that's how God speaks, why don't I hear Him more often? If He's talking so much in so many ways, why don't more people hear Him more often? So today I want to talk about how we listen. Because Jesus Himself actually answers that question for us in Mark chapter 4. And His answer is basically, well, God is speaking. Whether or not you hear Him depends on how you listen. And there's some different ways to listen. And whether or not you hear Him depends on which one you are. So we'll pick up the story here. Jesus is in the midst of His ministry on earth, traveling around, teaching, healing people, doing miracles. And Mark tells us, starting in verse 1 there, it says, "Again, Jesus began to teach by the lake. The crowd that gathered around Him was so large, He got into a boat and sat in it out on the lake, while all the people were along the shore at the water's edge." Basically, better acoustics, right? If you've ever known about sound or anything, that your voice is going to carry really good. So it's a big crowd, okay? That's important. Remember that. "He taught them many things by parables." In other words, He used stories with like a symbolic spiritual point to teach them, right? "And in His teaching said this," verse 3, "Listen, a farmer went out to sow his seed." Which, as soon as He said that, people back then would have thought of a farmer with a little pouch, probably not with a logo for David's on. But, you know, people back then would have pictured a farmer walking through a freshly plowed field with a little sack full of seeds at his side. And as he walked through the field, they just dropped seeds, just like that. And just kind of wherever they, just making sure you're awake. And just kind of wherever they would land, that's what would happen, right? All right. So, farmer is throwing out his seeds. Verse 4, "As He was scattering the seed, some fell along the path. And the birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky places where it didn't have much soil. It sprang up quickly because the soil was shallow. But when the sun came up, the plants were scorched and they withered because they had no root. Other seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plants so that they did not bear grain. Still other seed fell on good soil. It came up, grew and produced a crop, some multiplying 30, some 60, some 100 times. Then Jesus said, whoever has ears to hear, let them hear. Verse 10. When He was alone, the 12 and the others around Him asked Him about the parables." Okay, now time out. Stop there for a second, because I don't want you to miss something that I missed for years that left me kind of confused, right? Because it's huge on a couple of levels. If you notice, everything that happens next happened away from the crowd, right? Everything before verse 10 was in front of a big crowd. And then everything after verse 10, as it says, is later on, right, when Jesus was alone. I used to miss that part. I used to think He said this farmer parable, and then He explained it to the whole crowd. That's not what happened if you read this carefully, right? All the crowd got was a story about a farmer. Everybody's, what's Jesus going to teach? Here He is. I've been waiting to hear Him. What's He going to say? And He steps out. Oh, this is going to be good. He goes, so this farmer went out and threw some seed out, and it landed in different places. If you get it, you get it. You don't, bye. That's it. That's all the crowd got. Whoa, which understandably left the disciples kind of confused. Like, why did you do that? You just had a massive crowd. What? And Jesus' response is in verse 11. He says, "The secret of the kingdom of God has been given to you, but to those on the outside, everything is said in parables, so that they may be ever seeing but never perceiving, and ever hearing but never understanding. Otherwise, they might turn and be forgiven. You get that? Otherwise, Jesus says, so actually I did that so they wouldn't get it. What? Yeah. Because here's the thing. That way, Jesus says, I'll know who really wants to get it. I'll know who really wants to seek out the truth. I'll know who really wants me and isn't just here for some other weird reason. Because fact is, in any crowd, there's a million reasons why people are there, right? Especially back then. And even though he loved every single person and wanted every single person to be saved, he knew there were some there for bad reasons. He knew there were some there probably just for themselves. I saw him do some miracles. Maybe I'll get some free food out of this. Yo, let's just hang out. Maybe the free meals come in potluck. You know, there might have been some people there that were there for a political reason. Maybe I can get Jesus to join my cause. Let's see. Right? There may have been people there to nitpick him. We know that was a possibility back then. Let me see if I can catch him in something he says. Right? So many different possibilities, and Jesus knew that. And so while he loved every single one of them, he also knew, some of these people aren't here for the right reason. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to tell a story and leave it there. And those that really want to get it, they'll come after me. They'll ask, like the disciples did. They'll make the effort to go beyond the crowd and come to me personally and seek out the truth. And that's who I'll talk to. That's who I'll explain it to. Which, ironically, in this case, is also the point of the parable. I just find that so ironic, as he explains next, right? Look at verse 13. He says, don't you understand this parable? How then will you understand any parable? Because this parable is about listening, right? Because here's the deal. Verse 14, the farmer sows the word. In other words, the farmer in the story represents someone who preaches God's word, okay? Whether it's Jesus himself or you or me, it's a symbol for a person sharing God's message about his kingdom, okay? And the different soils, Jesus goes on to say, represent different ways of receiving that message. Verse 15, some people, he says, are like seed along the path where the word is sown. As soon as they hear it, Satan comes and takes away the word that was sown in them. Others, like seed sown on rocky places, hear the word and at once receive it with joy. But since they have no roots, they last only a short time. When trouble or persecution comes because of the word, they quickly fall away. Still others, like seed sown among thorns, hear the word. But the worries of this life, the deceitfulness of wealth, the desires for other things come in and choke the word, making it unfruitful. Others, like seed sown on good soil, hear the word, accept it, and produce a crop, some 30, some 60, some 100 times what was sown. Which obviously begs the question, okay, which one are you? Which one am I? Right? I mean, obviously Jesus wants us to be the good soil listener, but do we ever look like any of the others? I mean, that is the question for this series, because God is speaking, but whether or not we hear him depends on which one of these we are, which one of these we choose to be, right? Most people don't hear God because they're not listening like good soil. Some people, for example, are what we could call non-listeners. If you're taking notes, that's the first one there. Some people are non-listeners. They aren't even trying to listen, right? Ever met someone like that? Ever been in a conversation online with someone like that? Don't raise your hand. I have. It's the person whose heart is hard, basically, right? And Jesus uses this analogy of this soil that you find on a path. This one, right? I got this actually right near where we live. It's this hard, little, tiny, pebbly, rocky soil. And what happens is, right, when the seed, when God's word hits them, boom, can't even penetrate it because it's so hard. Some people's hearts are hard like a path, Jesus says. And when the message hits them, it just sits on the top. And then, as he says, the birds eat it, for Satan comes and takes it away. In other words, it's the person who's actually closed off to God's word by their own choice, right? They may argue in chat rooms about God and sound like maybe they're listening or open. They may even sit through a church service sometimes. But the reality is, they've closed off their heart, and it's so hard, they're not letting anything in. You can argue with them all day, and nothing will matter that you say. They're not even trying to listen. As Pastor Francis Chan said it so well one time, you know, as I'm doing what I'm doing here, where I'm teaching God's word, I can give the best sermon in the world ever. Not that I would be Jesus. But some people, as I'm throwing the seed out, this is all that's happening with them. That's it, okay? That is the person that is the hard soil. And that's a scary place to be. Don't eat them, they're going to fall on the floor. But Jesus says, when that's the case, says the devil actually comes and takes away whatever you might have gotten out of the sermon, right? Whatever that actually did make it to that person's heart, Satan's like, oh, you're not going to let it in? Well, I'll just remove it so it has no chance with you. And that's a scary place to be in. Because so often, you know, as I do debate atheists or whatever, there's this attitude like, I don't need Jesus, I'll go another way. You understand there is no other way? I mean, is Jesus or hell, literally? You walk away from him, there's nowhere to go, and that's a scary place to be. But while choosing to be a non-listener is a heartbreaking choice, and I wish I could make people listen, I wish I could listen for them, that's all there is to say about this one. Because honestly, if that's you, you're not listening anyway right now, so we might as well go on. All right, so second one is the fair-weather listener, Jesus says, which he represents with rocky soil, right? I got a good example of that one right here. Think about rocky soil. You ever try to plant something in soil that's full of rocks? Jesus says, you try to plant something there, there's nowhere for the roots to go. They can't get down deep, and then when the weather gets harsh, they're just going to die. Rocky soil, right? Jesus says some people's hearts, some people's listening is kind of like that. And it's this idea, as he says, they receive the word with joy when they hear it. Woo, this is awesome. I love this Jesus stuff, right? But they have no root. In other words, they never take the time to sink their roots in. They never take the time to explore what they believe or why they believe it, right? They never do the hard work of getting into the Bible for themselves. They never really surrender their lives completely to Jesus. It's still really all about them, and Jesus is just something else fun to do when it suits me, right? They're more like fans, as Kyle Idleman, a pastor in Louisville, says. More like fans than followers. And you think about a fan. What does a fan do? A fan cheers when the team's winning. When the team's losing, they change the channel, you know? Followers, though, go outside and actually start throwing a ball back and forth to be like the team. He says, man, fans of Jesus love the fun parts. They love the Bible verses about being blessed. They love the potlucks, the rockin' music, the fun events, free stuff. But that's as far as their commitment goes. It doesn't go any deeper. And Jesus says, when things get tough, and you know they will get tough, you follow Christ, this world will not be nice to you. When things get tough and being a Christian actually costs them something, Jesus says, they'll walk away. They leave because they never really gave control of their lives to Jesus. They never really sent their deep roots in. So when the tough times come, well, why are these happening? And just walked away, which again is scary because you walk away from Jesus. There's nowhere else to go. Jesus says, don't be like that. And watch out for the third one too, what we'll call the distracted listener. Huh? If you just said, huh, that might be you. Okay, distracted listener. Right? Distracted listener. Anybody actually a fan of weeds out there, like in your yard you're trying to do? Yeah, no, me either. So I got these from behind our place too. Jesus says, you know, some people listen kind of like this weedy soil where, yeah, okay, the seeds might get in the soil and might produce something or start to grow, but the weeds grow with it and choke it out. He said, you know, weeds are kind of like these things that you let distract you in life. As he says, the worries of this life, the deceitfulness of wealth. I just need to make a little more, man. I just need to make a little more. The desires for other things. Well, I know church is this morning, but man, my favorite team's playing football at 10 a.m., you know. I mean, those things, the weeds of life come in and choke the word and make it unfruitful. Right? See, this is the person in this case who maybe really does want to follow Jesus and really does want to get it, but they just think there's so much else they have to do or so much else they want to do that they let those things pull them away from Jesus and time with him, and they never really live out anything they did hear God say. And I have been so guilty of that one. I think our culture fosters this one, right? As someone once said, if the devil can't make you bad, he'll make you busy. You know, if you can't take your foot off the accelerator, he'll press it down all the way and make you so busy you have no time for God or Jesus or church. It's a constant fight, especially when you have three jobs, okay? Constant fight. But Jesus says that's a fight worth fighting because the reality is there's nothing in life more important than him. And whatever weeds you might have to clean out and throw away, man, do it. It's worth it. Reprioritize your day around Jesus and what matters most. We had a good talk about this in our house church this past week. And this idea of the top 5%, you guys remember that? This pastor in Hawaii that we're basing the house church on his DVDs, he says, you know, you think about, oh, I'm so busy, there's so much I have to do. If I don't do it, it won't get done. Okay, but time out, really think through your life for a second. 85% of what you do, anyone could do, right? Anyone can answer emails, anyone can mow the lawn, some of you parents probably wish someone else would, you know, anyone can walk the dog, anyone can wash the car, anyone can go to the store. 85% of what you do, anyone can do. It doesn't have to be you. 10% of what you do, a lot of people with some training could do, right? Whether you're a dentist, a doctor, a janitor, it doesn't matter. You give a good amount of people some training, the same training you've had, they could take that job over for you too. But 5% of what you do, only you can do, right? If you're in college, only you can get your degree. Someone else doing it for you is called cheating, okay? If you're married, only you can be the spouse to your spouse. If you have kids, only you can be their mom or their dad, right? And only you can keep yourself healthy, and only you can have your relationship with God. No one else can do that for you. And so when life does get busy, and there's so many weeds around you can't even see, which one do I go? Wayne Cordero in our house church goes, man, just remember the top 5%. You know, if I don't spend, I like to spend 3 sessions preparing a sermon. But if life gets busy and Amy gets sick and I gotta take care of her, something comes up and I miss one of those, you know what? The Holy Spirit will take care of it. And there's other people that could preach. I mean, I love doing this, but I know someday, there were preachers before me, someday I'll die. It'll be more unless Jesus comes back first, you know? But only I can be your husband, you know? Things like that. Don't let go of things in the top 5% for the sake of things anyone can do, you know? Now, that's not to say don't work at your job and don't, you know, do laundry. Please do laundry. Please do laundry before you come to church, right? It's just saying if the clock is running out of time for the day and you didn't take your time with Jesus yet and the laundry's not done, laundry can wait till tomorrow. Take your time with Jesus, you know? Focus on that top 5%. That's the idea. Put God first. And, as Jesus basically urges us, be the good soil. Be an active listener, as we'll call it. Because of the four, this is the one that's really going to hear God. Why don't most people hear God? Because, you know, and I don't know if it's a one-fourth, like, if Jesus is literal, but yeah, about one-fourth of the world is all that's listening to God. Maybe less, I don't know, but probably even less than that. But there's a lot of people who fall in those first three categories. I have at times. And he goes, if you're trying to hear God, it's not going to work in those first three categories. You got to make every effort to be an active listener. What does that mean? It's a person who does what the disciples did. You know, you ever read a passage in the Bible and you don't get it and you go, well, oh well, close it and walk away? That's what the crowd did. Jesus tells his story and they go, well, that was weird. And they walk away. The disciples went after him and said, wait, I want to understand this. What was that about? And Jesus said, that's what I want to talk to. You're the good soil. You don't just leave it there when you don't get something. You seek it out. You want to live it out. The person who seeks Jesus, be that person who spends time just listening at the feet of Jesus, like Mary did. You guys know that passage? We'll read that in a second. But be the person who listens and then constantly asks, man, how am I going to be different from what I just read? How am I going to be different from this passage we looked at today? What can I do to apply this to my life? Like Mary. In fact, let's go over there for a second. If you have your Bibles, just turn a few pages to Luke chapter 10. After Mark is Luke, and then just go to Luke chapter 10. Or if you're using our Sunday morning mobile site, it's already on there. Just scroll down a little more. Luke chapter 10. And let's read this, because this is just the perfect example of good soil listening versus thorny soil listening, that's for sure. Mark chapter 10. I'm sorry, Luke chapter 10. If you're watching at home, you guys do this too. Luke chapter 10. Starting down in verse 38, says this. As Jesus and his disciples were on their way, he came to a village where a woman named Martha opened her home to him. She had a sister called Mary who sat at the Lord's feet listening to what he said. But Martha was distracted. Oh, keyword, circle, underline, highlight, thorny soil. There it is, distracted by all the preparations that had to be made. She came to him and asked, Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to do the work by myself? Tell her to help me. Anyone else, when you get stressed out, you start bossing everyone around? Yeah, don't raise your hand. Okay, verse 41. Martha, Martha, the Lord answered, you're worried and upset about so many things, but few things are needed, or indeed only one, top 5%. Mary has chosen what's better. It will not be taken away from her. Now, right off the bat, I have to tell you, I get Martha, because I'm a lot like her, okay? Look back at verse 38, okay? Notice what it says. First, it says, as Jesus and his disciples were on the way. Okay, so already we're starting with 13 people, one of whom is the Son of God himself, right? Anyone ever try to prepare dinner for 13 people without any advance notice? Not an easy task, right? Especially if it's, you know, everything's closed or something. Let alone if it includes Jesus himself. Because then I want everything to be perfect, right? I mean, this is like get out the best silverware, the best china. I'm not just gonna cook for you, I'm gonna make the best thing I know how to make, because it's Jesus and his 12 guys, and oh my gosh, this is gonna be crazy. And so that's a big job. And yet it says Martha chose to open her home to him. She said, come on in, and I'll make dinner for you. Man, she said, I'll do it. I love you guys. Come on in. And off to work she went, acting honestly like I do. Oh, it's Jesus. I gotta do my best for Jesus. I gotta do a million things for Jesus. It's gotta be the best. I gotta do all this stuff. Distracted, Luke says, by all the preparations. Which, in theory, were good preparations. I mean, it's for Jesus. I doubt he was angry at her for wanting to do her best for him. Nothing wrong with that. The problem, though, as Jesus points out, was Martha got so busy doing things for Jesus that she didn't spend any time with Jesus. Martha got so busy doing things for Jesus, she never spent any time with Jesus. And all that led to, in reality, was stress, wasn't it? Why am I so stressed out? I'm a Christian. Well, how much time are you spending with Jesus versus doing things for Jesus? She just ends up stressed, frustrated, snapping at people, even bossing Jesus himself around, if you notice. I mean, is that enough to start bossing other people around? You're going to boss the Son of God around? Tell her to help me. Okay. That's when you know you're stressed out, right? And Jesus so beautifully responds, Martha, Martha. I wonder if he said her name twice just to call her back to reality. You know, it's like, Martha.
Yeah, what?
Martha, you are worried and upset about many things. I see that. I get that. But few things are needed. Only one, really. Focus on the top 5%. Mary chose what's better, and it won't be taken away from her. She's not being lazy. She's being smart, right? I'm sure he appreciated the heart behind what Martha was trying to do, but realize Jesus would much rather have time with you than you running around doing a bunch of stuff for him. Now, don't misunderstand. That's not to say we don't do things for him. We're going to talk. That's a whole sermon coming in a couple weeks. But here's the thing. If I don't spend time with Jesus first, how do I know what to do? I'll just run around with like a chicken with my head cut off, trying this and trying that, trying that. How much better is it to take 5 minutes and pray and read the Bible and let Jesus say, hey, today, don't focus on this or this, focus on that, and then you can actually get more done and actually have a more effective day and do it with peace instead of stress and freak out. Doing does come, but the listening part comes first. Even Jesus modeled that, right? He gets away. People can't even find him. He's praying all night. Then he goes, okay, we're going to go to the next city now. How did he know where to go? Time listening first. Jesus gets away and pray. He comes down and says, hey, I'm going to pick some disciples now. Calls the 12. How do you know which 12? Took time to listen first. Listen first. You read Genesis chapter 1, for goodness sake, and it's so weird to us, but it goes right over our heads. How did God create time? First evening, then the day. You rest, then you work. You don't work and then rest in God's perspective. You rest and then work. You listen and then do. You start at Jesus' feet, then you go out there and be his hands, right? Jesus says you got to start with the listening part. So start there, he says, by being the good soil. You guys ever have like a planters at home and stuff and you get that just that really good soil that makes, like this has like miracle growing in it. I don't even have to try because I'm not good at plants. Amy can tell you. I didn't have to try. You just plant something in this and it's like huge in 2 days. You're like, now I need a bigger pot. Ah, you know, because it's good soil. It listens. It accepts the seed that you plant on it and actually nurtures it and helps it grow. And it becomes beautiful things. So Jesus says, become the good soil. How do we do that? By going back through the sermon in reverse. What? Think through the soils. Think of what he said not to do and do the opposite. Right? First off, instead of coming with a closed heart, go into the Bible with an open heart. Be ready to listen to whatever God wants to say, whether you want to hear it or not, because a lot of times it might be about 50-50. There are the verses that are comforting, and then there are the verses that are convicting. Some of those might have been today for you. They are for me, right? Go into the Bible every day with an open heart instead of a closed heart. And don't be the rocky soil, right? Don't rush it. Don't ignore things. Set aside time instead, to dig your roots into the Bible. How long is it long enough, Matt? I don't know. How long do you need? At least 15 minutes? 30 seems usually about right for me. Sometimes we don't have a big attention span. That's all we can get. That's cool. God's like, just glad you showed up, man. Let's talk. It's Spend some time digging in. And don't get distracted like the thorny soil, right? Find a quiet place with no distractions. I know they exist. I promise they exist. It might take some work. But again, what does Jesus say at the beginning? Hey, I'm here for the ones that'll put out the effort to seek me, right? Whatever it takes. Find a place with no distractions. I promise they exist. You may have to get creative, but he's worth it. And then, like Mary, spend time just sitting before Jesus, so to speak, just listening. Just take your time with the Bible, no rushing, right? And then he says, like good soil, go produce results. Go do what he says to do. There is the doing part, but the listening comes first, or you won't know what to do. Why don't more people hear God speak? Simple, because they don't do that. They don't do the good soil stuff. They live path soil lives, rocky soil lives, thorny soil lives. But if you really want to hear from God, you got to understand it's not enough to just know how he speaks. You got to know how to listen. And that's it right there from Jesus. Live that good soil life. But start there this week, man. Intentionally, daily, and just watch what happens. Okay, Matt, you might say, but sometimes I just get confused as I read the Bible. Like, I'll be reading along and think God's telling me to do something, but how do I know it's not just my own thoughts? How do I know it's not the devil trying to trick me? He knows the Bible too. That is a great question that we will answer. So come next week, and we'll talk about that. This week, focus on being a good soil. Let's pray. Father God, help us be the good soil. Help us come with open hearts every time we open your word. Help us listen carefully, dig deeply into it, when it says what we want to hear, and especially when it says what we need to hear that we may not want to. Help us clear out the weeds that distract us and guard that precious time with you, Jesus. Thank you that you want it with us. Thank you that you took the guilt, you took the shame, anything that might come between us, you took it away at the cross to make the way for us to have this time with you. Without guilt or shame. Help us just get into your words, Jesus, and get them into our lives and go live them out. With your eyes closed, heads bowed just for a second, nobody looking around. You know, like we said last time, the reason God wants to speak to us in the first place is because he loves us. He loves you. He wants a relationship with you. He wants it so badly, he did die on the cross in your place for all the stuff you feel guilt for, shame for. All that stuff God could send you to hell for, honestly, Jesus says, I'll take that on myself so you don't have to. That's what the cross is about. God in human form taking on himself the responsibility and the punishment for every bad thing you and I have ever done so we could go free. And then 3 days later, he rises from the dead. He actually beats death itself and returns to life. That's what we celebrate on Easter. Historical fact we can prove. We will in a couple weeks. But right now, through Jesus, God offers you everything you can't do for yourself. He offers you complete forgiveness, eternal life that starts right now with hope and peace and all the things he meant for you to have from the beginning. A second chance. And the best part is, it's his gift just because he loves you. You don't have to earn it. You can't earn it. All you can do is accept it, just like any gift. Jesus says you do that by repenting. This fancy Bible word that means to make a U-turn in life. Stop trying to do it your way. Stop trying to go your own way in life. Just stop. Turn around. Put your trust in what Jesus did to save you and follow him. Have you ever done that? If not, would you like to right now? He wants you to. So stop fighting me. Just let me in. In a second, I'm going to pray a very simple prayer. I invite you to pray with me. These aren't magic words, but if you just want some help with what to say to Jesus to make that happen, that relationship with him begin and that salvation get activated, I invite you to pray with me. It's more about what's in your heart than the words. I'll say it out loud. You can say it silently, just between you and him and your thoughts. He can hear those. As you mean it, that's what counts. Just pray this with me if that's what you want. Dear God, I'm sorry for all the bad I've done. Thank you for sending Jesus to save me. Thank you, Jesus, for dying for me. And thank you, God, for raising him from the dead. Jesus, please come into my life and save me. Help me follow you from this day forward. And thank you. And Father, for anyone watching at home or here today that prayed that, please just help them have that reassurance that you heard them. Wrap your arms around and walk with them through the next steps of just one day at a time. And thank you for a new life in Jesus. Thank you for wanting a relationship with us. Everything that comes with that. Help us this week to be good listeners.